It is a particular honor this evening to welcome Elias Shakur, the Archbishop of Galilee of the Melkite Catholic Church. A noted author and a peace activist, Archbishop Shakur has been nominated 3 times for the Nobel Peace Prize. He has authored 2 best-selling books, Blood Brothers and We Belong to the Land. In the early 80s, Archbishop Shakur started a school in the town of Ibelin in Galilee to educate disadvantaged Palestinians. And the school, which began with a one classroom of 20 students, has grown to over 4,000 students from kindergarten through high school. There are over 100 teachers in the high school alone, some Muslim, some Christian, some Palestinian, and some Jewish. And he is months away from establishing an accredited university. He has hinted that if he could get some Holy Cross religious to assist him in this endeavor, he would gladly welcome them. It is an honor for us as a community to welcome a man who has done so much for so many.
It's an honor and privilege to be with you this evening, and I would like to say my gratitude to the committee and to all those who accepted to host a person who is rather a walking contradiction. And that's what I am, in fact. I hope you will never forget me. You don't have every evening a Palestinian who stands in front of you and tries to introduce some of his life experiences as a young human being who was born to a Palestinian family and meant to be a simple peasant of Galilee, and slowly, slowly, he became a visitor all around the world to share a story with his brothers and sisters, the human beings. Well, may I unfold a secret for you? I was not born Christian. Thank God. Thank God. When I discovered that I was not born Christian, I think it was the major discovery in my life, and that was the key for me to go to the Jew and to the Muslim and to the Americans and ask them, what were you born? Christian, Muslim, Jewish, or you were like me? I was born a baby. And only a babe, but with birth certificate. I was created on the image and with the likeness of God. I have to struggle to protect my likeness with God. Because there are some people who look at their neighbors and consider them to be subhuman beings. I am not a subhuman being. Palestinian Arab Christian. I am also, to the confusion of many, I'm also a citizen of the State of Israel. And I love equally all the facets of my identity. But as a human being, I wanted to put a priority in my affiliation. Who am I first? Palestinian, Arab, Christian, or citizen of Israel? I could not agree to be first and above all a citizen of Israel. I have a slight problem with Israel. Israel is an entity which is 62 years old, and I am 71 years old. I'm older than Israel. I did not immigrate into Israel at an early age. It's when I was a young man, a new reality appeared in my country, Palestine. And the first image I got about the Jews was given to me by my father. He gathered us children and said, children, there are rumors. within a few days, we might see Jews coming to our village. This time they come with weapons. Be not afraid. They do not kill. These, Father said, are survivals of a certain satanic plan to destroy them all. And thank God, the man who planned that, meaning Hitler, was not able to fulfill his bad thoughts. Those who survived are coming to our country. We need to show them that somewhere on this planet they are most welcome, especially because they are our blood brothers. We and they pride ourselves to be the descendants of an Iraqi citizen whose name was Abraham. And Father said, we'll prepare a big banquet to receive the soldiers. And I ask you, children, to accept, to give up your beds for the soldiers. We'll sleep on the roof of our houses. That means they will be considered as the owner of the house, and we will be considered as the guests. This is typical Palestinian mentality. They came. They did not kill anybody. They did not molest anybody. They accepted our beds and we slept on the roofs. In Galilee, it's so pleasant to sleep on the roof of the houses. Don't do that here. If you can keep yourself warm inside, that's already an achievement. When you sleep on the roof, you can, if you are bored, start counting the stars, 10, 100,000, 10,000. From evening to morning, and in the morning you have the impression you're just starting to count. There are so many of them. We stayed 10 days on the roofs, after which the officer of the army called Manu ordered all heads of families, including my father, to come around to see him. And they received the orders to take wife and children, lock their doors, deliver the keys to this man, and go away for 2 weeks. He gave them a written promise, in 2 weeks you would return. What can simple peasant and armed do except obeying? I remember the evening when we left, I took a blanket on my shoulder, that's all I could carry. And we went just 1 kilometer away from homes and stayed on our lands under our olive, fig, almond trees and other trees. It was pleasant for 2 weeks, but after 2 weeks it becomes problematic. That's why the heads of families, my father included, gathered again and went back to see the army. The same officer. They went, but they never ever came back. They were loaded onto military trucks like cattle and driven from northern Galilee to the neighborhood of the city of Nablus in the West Bank, where the borders were set fresh. And the orders were clear, cross the borders, go away, this land does no more belong to you. If you try to come back, you will be killed before you trespass the borders. What can they do? They left. They walked down to the Jordan River and crossed the Jordan River. And they start their way of suffering, their Via Dolorosa. From Jordan to Amman, from Amman to Damascus, from Damascus to Beirut. And they were stuck in these Arab countries and became the famous Palestinian Arab refugees in the Arab countries. Till an American president would think himself taking place of God and says, these Palestinians should no more think of returning. They have to manage as they can. Yes, Mr. President, you're not God. Very few were able to infiltrate back through the northern borders with Lebanon and Israel. Among them was my father. That's how we knew what happened to them. My father did not stay still, waiting for the right to return. We have become refugees in an abandoned room in a next by village, Jish. He wanted always to return. He initiated the meeting of all remaining adults and heads of families, and they went to the Supreme Court of Justice in Israel. Resolution was in their favor. These are peaceful people. They have the right to return to their homes. The military opposed. They went back in 1950 for the second time. Second resolution was in their favor. Military opposed. They went the third time, 1951. And third resolution also, alike. So they decided to take wife and children and go home. It's a march of 2 hours only. And we started marching. When we reached the neighborhood of our village, we were going down on a hillside, and suddenly airplanes came, we did not know where from, and started raining bombs and explosives on our homes in front of our eyes. We stood there, seeing our homes fly in the air, our church partly destroyed. We stood there and wept. And that hillside is called since then the Bar'am People Wailing Wall. One of the most painful experiences in my life was just after that, a year later, when a certain Jew came to the village where we became refugees. He wanted to hire people to harvest what he said, his olives, his figs, his almond, his grapes. And these were our trees. And he wanted to hire our own people. And there was a strong discussion between the old and the young generation. The elderly one wants to go and collect their own fruits for that Jew, saying, if we go, we'll collect the fruits and we will save the trees. Otherwise, a foreigner would break the branches. And when we come back, we'll have no trees. I accompanied father and mother 3-4 days. While they were collecting our own figs for that Jew, I don't know who it was. I never saw the eyes of my father and mother dried all during that time. They were collecting their fruits with their tears. 1 year, 2 years, after that they noticed that they are becoming slaves of that Jew. They said, we stop. Let the trees be destroyed. When we come back, we shall plant new ones. My father died in 1992 in Haifa. We had no place to bury him. We carried him back to the cemetery of our village. Oh, it's not true that I say we don't have the right to return. We have the right to return, but after we die. We want to return alive. Maybe some Jew would be wandering around, not knowing where he's going. We'd like to give him hospitality back again. I delight taking Jewish friends from Israel back to my father's house that is in ruin and collect figs from my fig tree and give to these Jews, saying, eat, see how sweet are our fruits after 62 years of abandonment. My father was a very strange man. He wanted by all means that one of his children becomes a priest. And we are 4 brothers and 1 sister. The sister is excluded by nature. We are Catholics. So he sent my elderly brother to seminary in Jerusalem. He stayed there 3 months and escaped. He did not want that. My second brother threatened to commit suicide if father would send him to seminary. So he was not sent. My third brother escaped from Palestine to Jordan for fear of being sent to seminary. Who remained? The youngest. And I was the youngest. And my father delivered me to the bishop. I was too young to say yes or no. I just followed. It was exciting to leave the village on the status of refugee and to go to Haifa. And there I began to think, why not become a priest? After all, I would give my life to that champion, Jesus Christ, with whom I spent all my youth. I used to go away to climb on trees and sit there like Zacchaeus and feeling present to him, and he was present to me. After a while, I didn't start liking to become a priest. I said, that way I can give my life to restore the broken dignity of my people. Why not? Now, after 42 years of priesthood, oh gosh, if I have the possibility to choose again whether to be a priest or not, I simply would choose to be a priest. It is great. There is so much joy, so much suffering, so much pressure, but such a strong, undefeated faith that after all, you win because God is there to ask you constantly, follow me. And after 6 years of study at the Sorbonne and the Institut Catholique in Paris, I came back home. 1965, I was ordained priest in Nazareth. 1 week later, my bishop said, Elias, now you need to have a parish. So I decide to send you for 1 month, 30 days. 1 month to Ibeline. It's a village not far away from here. After 1 month, we'll decide your final assignment. I said, yes, sir. I could not ask a question for such a majestic bishop like Bishop Hakim in those times. I said, 1 month, it will go very fast. I did not know then what I know now, even by practice, that bishops, excuse me, normally have a very short memory. And my bishop forgot me there, and I forgot myself. I stayed in that village 38 years, waiting for the 1 month to finish. It would never have ended if the Synod of our bishops and John Paul II, of very good memory, did not almost impose on me to accept becoming the Archbishop of Galilee for the largest Catholic Church in Israel. And I had the honor to say yes. I did not know what that meant. If they would ask me now, I would say, let me think it over. When I came to Ibeline, I expected to find a bedroom, an office, a kitchen, at least toilets. Nothing of that. The only place I had to stay in was my Volkswagen bug that was given to me by a German family. So I lived for 6 months in the Volkswagen bug. Don't pity me, please. I don't need pity. It was so comfortable to sleep in the Volkswagen bug. You know why? Well, I was a priest, a young priest. I was not so big. I was much smaller. When you become priest, mainly in the Middle East, you tend to put on and on weight. I don't know why, but that's the case. It's only by the grace of God that I was able to continue my way. I started studying what happened to us Palestinians. And I realized very intensely that 1948 was a huge operation of ethnic cleansing of the Palestinians. 460 Palestinian towns and villages were completely destroyed or obliterated or emptied to prepare space for the coming of Jews from the Arab countries or from Europe or America. I realized that with the creation of Israel, the catastrophe, the plight of the Palestinians started, and we became the Jews of the Jews, the dispersed nation in the Middle East. We became dispersed into three major groups. Those who went to the neighboring Arab countries and became the Palestinian refugees in Lebanon, Syria, Jordan, Egypt, elsewhere. And those who did not want to go as far as the neighboring Arab villages and towns. They said, we'll stay in the territory of Palestine, which was not immediately under Jewish control. And that's what you call in your literature today, the West Bank, that comprises East Jerusalem, Hebron, Bethlehem, Jericho, Nablus, Jenin, and so on. And that's how these villages, these towns, are surrounded with hundreds of thousands of refugees. The most illustrious example would be Jericho. Jericho is a small village of 25,000 inhabitants, but two refugees on each side comprise 120,000 refugees. Gaza is another example, where people were pushed to the desert. Gaza is a piece of the Sinai Desert, full of sand. There were, in 1948, 8,500 original inhabitants in Gaza City. Suddenly it became swollen up, overpopulated, overcrowded, that now there are 1,500,000 refugees and 45,000 original inhabitants. These refugees did not come from the Arab countries or from Europe. They came from Jaffa, Lod, Ashdod, Ashkelon. They came from the 460 Palestinian towns and villages that were completely destroyed. And these were left in the desert, forbidden to enjoy any human right. They lived on bread and soup that was distributed by the UNRWA, United Nations Organization. And only 17 years later, they added to their deprivation the new occupation by Israel, Six-Day War, and they introduced to them the military checkpoints. A checkpoint can be in front of your house in the street. If you want to cross the street to go to school on the other side, you have to be there 3-4 hours before so that the Jewish soldier would comply to let you go in or send you back. And you come back, you have also to go 3 or 4 hours before the soldier would comply to let you go on. The third group of the Palestinians were the poorest among the Palestinian nation who could not go as far. They decided to stay in or around their villages and towns, like me. Normally, they agglomerated themselves into few centers that were still populated. Now we are 1,300,000 Palestinian Arabs with Israeli citizenship. That means we have Israeli passport. but not like the Jew has an Israeli passport. I am second-class citizen, he is first-class citizen. On my passport, if anyone wants to see, I can show you that. I am 02. Why, my Jewish friend, whom I helped to graduate in the Hebrew University, is 01 automatically. You know what, ladies and gentlemen, as a young Palestinian, I always wished to have heard some Christian leader standing up courageously 67 years ago and say, there can be no privilege for German against Jew. Nobody said that. A Muslim king said that, King Hassan of Morocco. And we are still waiting impatiently for such a leader to stand up and to say, here in the States, there in Israel, in Europe, everywhere, there can't be a justification for privileges for Jews against Palestinians.
At the global situation, it is very negative, it's very oppressive, very hopeless. But we do not need to be stuck into the past, into the oppressive side of our life. We have to take care of that, we have to remember that, but we have to go beyond that to plan today what we want our tomorrow to be. And that's what we are trying to do through education to our children. Not education in a kind of closedness, but education in an open-ended relation where we embrace the Jews who persecuted us, where we embrace the Muslims who sometimes do not like us, where we want them to get to know us that despite everything that happened against us, we are unable to learn one lesson, how to hate people. That's impossible.